In the Russian invasion of Ukraine, the city of Mariupol was exposed to ferocious attacks.
Нас обстреляли з танків. В підвалі були діти, пожилі, жінки.
Дуже багато мирних погибло, все в огні, все взривалось. Я не знаю, як я вижив в цій ситуації, тому що, по суті, оказався під перекресним вогнем.
May 2022. Mariupol was completely taken over by the Russian army. What exactly was going on inside the occupied city? We worked with experts to find clues from satellite images.
マリウポリの戦いが終わったわけではきっとなくて、
まだ住民の方も残っているし、やっぱり情報がなかなかやってこないジレンマはすごく感じています。We
examine more than 200 satellite images of Mariupol. They clearly show the reality of violent attacks targeting civilians. Where were all those who fled from Mariupol heading? In this edition of Digital Eye, using the latest digital technology, we unveil the truth buried in the ravages of war. Mariupol before the invasion. Facing the Sea of Azov, it was a prosperous industrial city. Home to more than 400,000 people, it was a place full of vitality.
Город, в котором я родился, в котором я вырос, состоялся и стал кем-то.
The symbol of Mariupol was the theater standing in the heart of the city. But the conflict has drastically changed its appearance. The number of Mariupol residents killed is still unclear. We decided to analyze the satellite data with professors Watanabe Hidenori and Furuhashi Taichi. We focused on comparing images of Mariupol cemeteries. It appeared that the soil had been dug up over an extensive area. Continuing our investigation, we found a video released in June. It showed grave markers erected over a large area. And one scene provides a clue confirming the video was filmed in Mariupol. In the distance, there's a rectangular building flanked by two chimneys. A search of the satellite images of the city led us to a factory. The features and position of the factory and chimneys perfectly match the video footage. This proves it was filmed at a cemetery in the western part of the city. So far, three large cemeteries in Mariupol have been identified using the satellite images. Since March, when the battle intensified, all three cemeteries have continued to expand. From the area per grave, we can estimate the number of people buried there. The expanded areas alone were found to be sufficient size for 7,000 graves. Desperate to survive, many residents have no option but to flee their city. Where were they all heading? We use cell phone location data to track and visualize the flow of evacuees from Mariupol. This is the situation before the invasion. The more red indicated, the greater the flow of people. Right after the invasion started on February the 24th, there was a surge of people moving west. Then, from mid-March, the flow largely disappeared. Why did this happen? Several residents explained what was going on at the time.
То есть вода заканчивалась еда, и было осознание того, что максимум еще здесь можно протянуть неделю. И на тот момент, когда уже решили выбираться, то начались бои в этом районе.
The head of a support group engaged in rescue operations says that evacuation routes from Mariupol to western Ukraine were basically closed at that time.
To get to Mariupol, you have to pass 20 checkpoints, military checkpoints, buses and large trucks with humanitarian, which were moved to, but has not been let in.
The only option left for the residents was to evacuate to the Russian-controlled areas.
Было страшно, конечно же, но, скажем так, страшнее, чем в Мариуполе, уже никогда не будет.
Нет оружия, нет взрывов, нет выстрелов, как бы вот этот вот мы выбрали, ну вот мы едем, да, мы получается едем в сторону России.
Many people rushed to the evacuation buses prepared by Russia. But what awaited them was a tense interrogation by armed soldiers.
Раздеться полностью. Потому что они осматривали кисти, ладони на предмет шрамов, на предмет мозолей, пороха и так далее. И браслет я хотел отдать девушке, а у меня его просто из рук забрал солдат внешне. И, скажем так, на тот момент их стояло там много человек, и возражать человеку с автоматом было как-то не ахти.
Денис is another Mariupol resident who boarded a bus provided by Russia. But for the next 9 days, he was moved and detained repeatedly without freedom.
Стойло для скота, который периодически приводят, выводят, проверяют, и это, ну, это не человеческое вообще. Это опять же, я же говорю, что лагерь какое-то унижение, показать, что вот вы посмотрите, кто мы и кто вы.
Repeated interrogations and long-term detentions. What is this all about? In August, a US research institute published a report titled System of Filtration. It dealt with detention operations designed to filter people in the Russian-occupied regions. It revealed details of the systematic filtration process being planned and conducted by Russia.
Hi there.
Nathaniel Raymond.
Yeah.
Pleased to meet you, sir.
Nathaniel Raymond headed the team that produced the report at Yale University. It's about delegitimizing their... Raymond is an expert on human rights issues in conflict zones. He's investigated many human rights violations, including those committed at Guantanamo Bay Detention Facility and Abu Ghraib Prison.
Russia has a distinct and specific history of using filtration in areas they occupy in a brutal and indiscriminate way. The obvious responsibility we had was to follow where we thought the largest probability of abuses occurring would be, and that is the filtration system.
Raymond geolocated 21 filtration facilities set up by Russia. One of them is at Bezimene, a village 30 kilometers east of Mariupol. Numerous reports had surfaced on the internet that filtration was taking place there. One example was this video filmed in March. We can see lines of tents and people who appear to be evacuees. Raymond's team compared and analyzed satellite images of Bezimene. In mid-March, tents suddenly appeared in the village square. Their color and layout matched the video images. Moreover, collation of the results from several sources confirmed that filtration was taking place.
We see vehicles lined up. People were being filtered coming out of the city. There are also buses, which suggests that people are being brought to this location en masse.
The Russian filtration system involves the registration of people, followed by interrogation, and in many cases, prolonged holding during investigation. In Bezimene, a school 600 meters from the village square was used to hold evacuees. This video was secretly filmed at the school. The video shows a large number of people who were forced to stay there.
Умывальник один на всю толпу, туалет вообще на улице. На улице.
Dennis was forced to stay at this facility for 6 days.
Там, по сути, кроватей почти не было. Спали на стульях, на партах, на полу. И там же уже без имени отравились там все. Потом уже позже сказали, что еду приготовили на технической воде.
Raymond points out that the evacuee filtration system involves abuses and human rights violations that are prohibited under international law.
From strip searching to renunciation of Ukrainian citizenship, and then repeated accounts of abuse.
They're trying to control the civilian population.
Dennis witnessed a woman being taken away during filtration.
Девушки нашли теробороны с кем-то. Связана она, ну, я не знаю, там, нашли запись теробороны, так вот, скажем. И что с ней было дальше, я тоже не знаю.
Evacuees who failed the screening process are believed to be sent to detention facilities elsewhere. Testimonies of torture at those facilities have been reported one after another. Many of those who have been detained remain silent, but one man who suffered a severe leg injury agreed to talk. He was a citizen volunteer carrying relief supplies who was arrested and tortured during more than 40 days of detention.
Думали, что я тоже состою в структурах спецподразделения каком-то. А от того, что они меня пытали током, ну, кроме дубинок там и этих палок, у меня лопнули перепонки в ушах. У меня в ушах, ну, как бы, с ушей была кровь, она была запекшаяся.
The Yale University report confirmed Olenivka, north of Mariupol, is one of the largest detention facilities. The Russians claim that the facility of Olenivka houses Ukrainian soldiers who have surrendered and that they are treated humanely. However, Raymond's team has pointed out that it's not just prisoners of war who are being detained there.
This facility holds both civilians who are in detention as part of the filtration system and prisoners of war.
Raymond noticed a change at this facility that suggested a serious situation. April. Many holes suddenly appeared in the ground in a corner of the property.
They are approximately 2 meters. They could fit a 6 foot tall individual.
By June, the holes had disappeared. However, in July, another area was dug up.
Does it prove it's a grave? No. Until there's a forensic team on the ground that can exhume those locations, we don't know. But it is consistent with activity or the lack thereof we would see on an alleged mass grave site.
Not long after, the detention facility was attacked and more than 50 inmates were reportedly killed. Both Russia and Ukraine denied the involvement of their military. The truth remains shrouded in darkness.
We are not the only ones with this concern. There is enough evidence to investigate Olenivka as a potential mass killing site.
At the end of the summer, this video came into our hands. It was filmed at great risk to let people know about the current situation in Mariupol. More than 100,000 people are said to remain in the city. Restoration of the city's infrastructure had been delayed, and it was difficult to secure food supplies. A Ukrainian humanitarian aid organization provided us with these videos. Even since the Russian occupation, they have continued to support the residents of Mariupol in defiance of strict controls.
People starving, simply. They have not enough food. This summer, so the number of dead people who just laying down in the street was horrible. Many people just died because of the sick, Those who are left there, they are normally elderly people, damaged or invalids. So the situation is critical there, is absolutely critical.
Around the same time, rapid changes were taking place on the outskirts of Mariupol. An unusual image was captured. Just a few months after the start of the Russian occupation, a massive construction site had appeared. On the Russian state-run media, we found this video, which shows part of the development plan for the site. The plan says they intend to rebuild Mariupol within 3 years, and construction is already underway. What is being built first is this apartment complex. Russia is emphasizing that the development is progressing for the sake of the people of Mariupol.
Не только жилые комплексы, но еще и медицинские центры строят.
It's not only the city infrastructure that is being reformed. In September, Russia held a so-called referendum and unilaterally declared its annexation of four regions. Schools reopened and began teaching in the Russian style in line with the Russian curriculum. Koizumi Yu, an expert on Russian policy and military strategy, says this is a typical Russian move in occupied territories.
完全にロシアに同化しようとするというのが、まあ前面出ているように見えます。なんか典型がやっぱりその教育をロシア語に切り替えて、ロシアの先生たちを送り込むみたいなやり方ですよね。プーチン大統領は戦争始める前に、ウクライナこそがロシア系住民を無理やり同化しようとしたんだっていうふうに非難してるわけですよね。で、それをやり返すんだみたいなところが前面出ているように見えますね。
Koizumi has continued his Russian military analysis using satellite imagery. Today, he's checking a military base on the northern territories that are claimed by Japan but controlled by Russia. He finds something unusual. In this September satellite image, the Air Force unit that would normally be there cannot be seen. So where did they go? When he takes a look at a Russian airbase near the Ukrainian border, helicopters and fighter jets are closely lined up.
Since
the start of the invasion in February, the Russian forces are said to have lost much of their military equipment. To get a better grasp of this, we turned our attention to an organization based in the Netherlands. It's an open source intelligence, or OSINT, research team called Oryx. It totalizes the number and type of the equipment that the Russian and Ukrainian forces have lost. It records only those pieces that have been verified by open source data, such as photographs and videos. Major media and research institutions often quote Oryx's data, regarding it as highly reliable. A central figure of Oryx accepted an interview with the Japanese media for the first time.
breaks is a block of open source researchers. We think our work is important to show the impact of changes in modern warfare on equipment and its use.
We have visualized the military equipment loss data accumulated by Oryx in graph form. Losses confirmed so far in Russia amount to nearly 8,000, which is 3.5 times greater than Ukraine's total of just over 2,200. Because this trend has continued ever since the start of the conflict, the nature of the Russian military losses has changed.
It started about a month after the invasions. It was very noticeable that almost all the equipment losses were very recent equipment. And after about a month, we have noticed increasing rate of equipment that was clearly in reserve, for example, 30, 40 years old. Example of this are Russian T-62M tanks, which is tank designed and made in 1960s. It's definitely more of a museum piece.
Ukraine's counteroffensive began in July. It has been accelerating the recapture of key locations in the eastern and southern regions, including Kharkiv and Kherson. Russian military expert Koizumi's analysis of the Oryx data focuses in on Russia's loss of tanks. Captured means equipment collected by the enemy. According to the November data, the number of Russian tanks captured amounted to more than 30% of the total number of Russian tank losses.
まあ、やっぱこう使えないように破壊して逃げるはずなんですよね。逃げる時の手順としてはあまりにもずさんなんじゃないかと。するとまあ、あの相当事態が切迫していて、もう破壊する手間も惜しいぐらいに追い込まれて逃げたケースであるとか、まあ、または本当にもう士気が低い、分かってるんだけどそれやらない奴らがいるとかですね。
Russian losses are piling up because of the protracted war. Yanovsky thinks it will be difficult for Russia to endure this situation.
Not sustainable, especially for Russia. And now Russia is trying to regain the superiority by calling up mobilization, which would solve its manpower problems and allow it to once again to maybe gain advantage, but give troops that you just mobilized and probably didn't train all that well, and you hand them equipment that their fathers might have served with 20, 30 years ago. It's hard to see who will have advantage.
For Ukraine as well, the maintenance of military power due to the prolonged fighting has become a major challenge. Against this backdrop, digital donations are rapidly spreading. This figure holding a Javelin anti-tank missile is called Saint Javelin. This internet meme has gained great popularity. Various goods have been made and sold online around the world to raise funds for Ukraine. The resulting donations have amounted to nearly $2 million.
Ну, нам потрібно всім зібратися і задля перемоги всім донатити.
Здається, цей шлях до перемоги мені складним, і мені здається, ну, я думаю, що кожен має робити щось, що в його силах.
We buy body armor, optic devices, scopes, drones, medical supplies, and cars for the military.
Donations by citizens have greatly contributed to supplies for the Ukrainian forces. One of the largest civic groups in Ukraine is the Seruhi Pratua Charity Foundation. With more than 100 active volunteers, it has a network in 9 locations throughout Ukraine. The group is organized by Seruhi Pratua.
Сергій Притула!
Appearing on numerous talk shows as a comedian, Pratua is a very popular figure in Ukraine.
We help to everyone who fights for Ukraine. Doesn't matter, are you volunteer fighters, or are you from armed forces.
The donation drive using the Bayraktar drone has made the Pratua Foundation world famous. The Bayraktar is a type of military drone manufactured in Turkey. Remotely controlled, they can fly for up to 27 hours. Bayraktars have destroyed tanks and Russian combat vehicles one after another, making them a symbol of Ukrainian resistance.
Прийшли окупанти до нас в Україну, форма новенька, воєнні машини.
Та трохи поплавився їх інвентар.
Bayraktar!
The more Bayraktars Ukraine can acquire, the more advantage it can gain. The price of each drone, however, is $5 million. They're not cheap.
Любі українці, цей день настав. Ми купуємо Bayraktari.
Pratua launched a campaign named People's Bayraktar to buy 3 drones. And then?
Підходьте, пробуйте, гроші солодкі, як мед.
Такі притулі гроші на Bayraktar.
Ти чого мені квіти не купив?
Я лачено з притулою все на Bayraktar скину.
In the blink of an eye, the donation drive spread nationwide. The goal of $15 million was achieved in just 3 days. The final total was $20 million.
I was happy because it was a project not only about drones, but also that was about Ukrainian unity.
Just as they were about to purchase the long-cherished Bayraktars, there was an unexpected turn.
So again, we donated 3 more to Ukraine.
Just use it for Ukraine. The manufacturer himself donated 3 Bayraktars to Ukraine.
How I feel? At first, I thought that it was a joke. I never met somebody who make a gift in $15 million, you know. But the next step was what we can do to make them happy, 100% of them.
What was the best use of the donations for the people of Ukraine? Pratua's decision was to purchase a satellite.
Our intelligence, they explain how it's important for us. So we are first charitable foundation in the world that bought a satellite.
The satellite purchased by the foundation is a radar-based SAR satellite, which can capture images even in bad weather or at night. Moreover, its use enables image capture every few hours, making it possible to monitor Russian military movements in almost real time.
We are extremely proud of that, and we are extremely eager to share this technology with others for the good use.
I'm happy that it works. I have a possibility to work and to help. I do it for my people and for my country. That's all those technologies, it's possible only because of IT technologies. It helps.
The Digital Eye team continued to track the whereabouts of the Mariupol evacuees by analyzing the cell phone location data. Red indicates the locations where a lot of movement occurred in the 7 months following the invasion. A major eastward flow into Russia and then northward emerged. This shows that evacuees from Mariupol were on the move inside Russia. The Mariupol evacuees we interviewed are currently living in Germany as refugees. How did they manage to escape from Russia? A common feature of their stories is that they pass through Taganrog, a Russian city near the border with Ukraine. A large number of refugees from Mariupol were temporarily housed at a sports center in the city. They reported that the promotion of settlement in Russia was being conducted there.
Заходишь, у них там агитационная такая листовка, типа Хабаровск вас ждет.
И мне друг скинул на телефон, что говорит, если говорит, вас попытаются отправить куда-то в Россию, текай говорит, из колонны. Там расселяли и оттуда отправляли по России.
If the refugees did not want to settle in Russia, they had no option but to flee. However, they had neither the information nor the means.
До этого все было забрано. За, все было за брата, там, я не знаю, два ноутбука у меня было. Остались у чеченцев, они забрали.
Мы просто не знали, как выехать, то есть в какую сторону ехать. Сестра нашла Надю, ну, как бы группу Надю, и дала заявку, и вот так вот мы.
This is the site of an organization based in Germany that her relatives have been able to locate. This organization is helping Ukrainian refugees to make it safely into Europe and providing help regarding evacuation through Russia. When refugees enter the required information for help on this site.
Нам просто дали контакт. Нам сказали, вот этот человек вам поможет.
Я позвонил своим родным, и они связались с питерскими волонтерами.
The contact information of the Russian person who would assist in the escape was sent to Victoria. Her name was Nadia. When Victoria sent a message to Nadia, she replied instantly. I'll remit you 5,000 rubles immediately, and I'll arrange a taxi for you. Victoria took the taxi arranged by Nadia and moved to the largest city in the area, Rostov-on-Don, about a 90-minute drive from Taganrog. From there, Nadia instructed her to take the train to St. Petersburg. Nadia had made the arrangements online for the tickets based on the ID information Victoria had sent her in advance.
Nadia покупала и билет на поезд, и она же оплатила не только дорогу такси, она еще дала нам деньги, ну, которые волонтеру перечислила, там еще были деньги на продукты на дорогу.
They arrived in St. Petersburg. It's a major city close to the borders with Estonia and Finland. Both Victoria and Dennis were going to meet Nadia there for the first time.
Там она уже нас забирала своей машиной и сама уже нас забирала. Татуировка, украинский флаг, на, ну вот здесь вот выбита.
Ну, я не знал, что за человек. Человек, ну, располагает тебе. И когда она еще показала, что у нее там за флаг Украины.
So who is this Russian Nadia who is supporting the Mariupol refugees? After lengthy negotiations, she contacted us to say that she would be willing to do an interview. We head to Germany to meet her.
Hello!
We're greeted by Nadia Juda Kolobaiwa, aka Nadia. As a Russian who has been helping Ukrainian refugees, Nadia fled from her native country to Germany, along with her partner and daughter.
And her daughter, Vaira.
Hello.
Hello.
It's our new friend from IKEA.
On her arm is the Ukrainian flag tattoo, as mentioned by the refugees.
I do the tattoo supporting Ukraine.
Nadia has so far assisted about 30 Ukrainian refugees. Victoria and Denis had both been taken in Nadia's car from St. Petersburg to the Estonian border and safely escaped from Russia.
Человек спас жизнь. Вот как? Ну вот это вот, ну это не благодарность, понимаете? Это, ну я не знаю, ну...
Nadia revealed to us that many other Russians are involved in the refugee support activities. The Russian volunteers exchange information in secret communities on social networking sites.
Гласит, никогда не называйте этот чат нигде, ни в социальных сетях. Если просто набрать их в поисковике, то их не найти.
И все это практически подпольная организация.
The number of members in the St. Petersburg community alone exceeds 10,000.
Именно организация – это самоорганизация людей. И помогают кто чем может.
According to Nadia, the support communities have coordinators who organize the efforts of many volunteers. The coordinators receive information on refugees in Ukraine via the internet. They then allocate the necessary support to volunteers. This is the kind of message that comes from the coordinator. A volunteer with a car is needed to take refugees from St. Petersburg to near the Estonian border. They include a 70-year-old. Can someone provide a folding chair for a girl who injured her leg in Mariupol?
И вот таких заявок от беженцев, они абсолютно любые. Работа координатора, на самом деле, она самая сложная.
The coordinators play a pivotal role in the support. We were able to interview one of them. As an archbishop in St. Petersburg, he has been engaged in charitable church activities.
After 24th of February, we understand that it's necessary to do something. The refugees from Ukraine, maybe the main problem that they have no information. It's necessary to help people just to travel. You know, Russia is not so small country.
He told us the Russian support community is working with Ukrainian and European support groups to ensure the safe movement of refugees.
We are in a contact with our Ukrainian colleagues. Let me say, it have no structure. Heart to heart, people to people.
thanks to the St. Petersburg supporters, more than 8,000 Ukrainian refugees have so far been able to escape from Russia.
Когда из со всего земного шара в одну секунду несколько людей могут объединиться вокруг одного, которому нужна помощь. Hello!
Nadia keeps in touch with the refugees she has helped. Today she has a chat with Victoria, who, like her, is now in Germany.
Ну а что там Василий с Виталием? Чем занимаются?
Ну, Виталий же пошел в школу.
Так.
У нас две школы. У нас немецкая школа, и вторая смена у нас украинская школа.
Victoria has been settled in a safe place, but she still longs for the day she can return to Mariupol.
Ну, конечно, жалко, что разрушили и разбили все, что нам было дорого, но как только будет Украина, мы сразу же вернемся в свой город. Я как любила свой город, так и люблю.
После начала войны, когда я осознавала уже всю степень вины у россиян, всех россиян, которые соглашались с этим режимом, и я и себя из этого числа не исключаю. У меня вот сегодня на календаре 6 сентября, а для меня по-прежнему 24 февраля, и зима, и весна не начнется.
И сейчас получается, что я примерно чувствую себя так же, как мои беженцы. Понятно, что я не пережила и тысячной части этих ужасов, которые пережили они.
November. Mariupol. On some days, the mercury is already falling below zero. How do the residents spend their days? We have no way of knowing that, except through citizens' messages on social networking sites and via the Russian media. In their damaged homes, people prepare for the onset of the harsh Ukrainian winter.
Здравствуйте. Зиму жить. Как думаете, зиму эту жить?
Не знаем. Сейчас пока под вопросом.
Понятно.
Запаслись на всякий случай.
Вот она, печка.
Окон нема, воды у нас тоже нет.
Окон у нас нет, а сам ничего, воды нема, нет.
Не переедем, тут все уже готовое, уже давно. Окон нету, двери сделали.
On the wall of an apartment block in the city of Mariupol, there are these words.